You're listening to the audio production of The Passion Generation, the seemingly reckless, definitely disruptive, but far from hopeless millennials, by Grant Skeldon with Ryan Casey Waller, published by Zondervan and read by Mark Smeby. Please note that you may download an accompanying PDF that provides enhanced materials for this audiobook. To download the PDF, please visit zondervan.com/p/PassionGenerationAudio.
Online experience at PassionGen.online. We live in a time when there are several options for taking in a good book, from print books to audiobooks to ebooks, but I'm taking it a step farther. The Passion Generation is riddled with references to videos I've handpicked to amplify and reinforce your listening experience. Each video is embedded in order on the book's site, PassionGen.online. I will call out these videos as we go through the book. Whenever you hear me talk about a video on the website, one, simply pull up PassionGen.online on your phone or laptop. Two, scroll to the matching video title. The videos in this book are must-see material, some informative, some inspiring, some sobering, and some that are just downright funny. But all of them will help you get the most out of the Passion Generation, so don't miss out. Part 1. Discipling Millennials. Chapter 1. The Generation Gap. March 8, 2006 was the biggest day of my life. Before I tell you why, allow me to tell you a little bit about myself. I was 16 years old, and like most high school kids, I found my identity in something other than God. To me, Jesus was a good guy, and I knew he was real, but I didn't want him yet. He was nice, but he was also a killjoy. I wanted to have fun first and then settle down later. I told myself, I'll be a Christian when I'm 26. I'm not kidding. I planned an age to become a Christian. It was pretty ridiculous, but it reveals how much I didn't get it. God didn't sit on the throne of my heart. Instead, I replaced him with typical substitutes. First, it was basketball. I had always loved the sport and been identified as a basketball player. My friends and I played all the time. Second, there was my girlfriend. We had been together for 3 years, which is basically forever in teenage years, so everyone thought we were going to be high school sweethearts. She was the girl on the hip-hop team, and I was the guy on the basketball team. It was like a ghetto high school musical in the making. And yes, you heard that right. My school had a hip-hop team. It's probably a good time to tell you that I grew up in a part of Dallas that was a little more urban, which is a euphemism for growing up with a lot of Hispanics and African Americans. This was pretty awesome because I'm Hispanic and African American. My mom is a 5-foot little Mexican lady, and my dad is a 6-foot-4 South African man. They're definitely a unique duo, but I'll be honest, I feel like a Mexicant because I can't speak any Spanish, and my dad is white, so he's not what people expect when I tell them he's from Africa. Once when I spoke in Uganda, I joked that I was technically African American, but when I told them my dad was South African, they laughed and said, "That doesn't count." My upbringing is important for you to know because the third thing on the throne of my heart was the approval of people. I, like many high school kids, cared a lot about what people thought of me. I just wanted to fit in and be liked, but it's hard to fit in when you always feel different. Our culture shapes a lot about us: food, dress, music, hobbies, values. Being Mexican but not feeling Mexican, and being South African but not feeling South African, made it pretty hard to figure out my identity. Who am I? What am I supposed to be like when I'm diverse and everyone else isn't? Luckily, my high school was radically diverse. So for the first time in a long time, I felt like I belonged. Things were great. Our basketball team was good, my girlfriend was legit, and I had just landed my first job at my favorite clothing store, Marshall's. I was living the dream. Then in 1 week, everything came crashing down. On Monday, my girlfriend cheated on me. On Wednesday, I was kicked off the basketball team. And by Friday, my popularity was washed down the drain. Everyone was talking about me, but not the way I wanted them to. I know it sounds dramatic, but from my limited teenage perspective, life was over. Everything I had been passionate about and everything I had placed my identity in was gone. I had no girlfriend to spend time with, no basketball practice to attend, no friends to go see, just gossip to avoid and feelings to numb. So when I got invited to a youth group I'd never been to before, I accepted the invitation. I wasn't really interested in finding God, but I was now single, and I was told there were hot girls there, so I went. It wasn't my first time in church, but it was the first time I went of my own volition. I had attended only when my mom dragged my brothers and me along. It wasn't that I hated church, but I definitely didn't like it. I just had never really connected with anyone there. Like most millennials, I craved authenticity, and the church just didn't seem authentic at all. But that night, church went from being fake to being the most hopeful place on earth. For the first time, I heard the good news in a way that was real to me. I realized that the reason I was in shambles was because I'd placed my identity in things that wouldn't matter in eternity. My whole life unraveled in 1 week because God wasn't my foundation. I was tired of trying to earn the approval of man instead of simply receiving the approval of God. So on March 8, 2006, I placed my future in the hands of a God who would never leave me. The very next day, God gave me back my girlfriend, my spot on the team, and my popularity. Okay, that didn't happen. God didn't give me my old life back, and in the end, I didn't want it anymore. I had Him, and I didn't need anything else. The crazy thing about God is He can change your life without changing your circumstances. After my conversion, I returned to the same heartache that crushed me, but I was different inside. God was now in me, and I didn't care anymore about what people thought. Leonard Ravenhill once said, "A man who is intimate with God will never be intimidated by man." I didn't know it at the time, but God was just getting started. It wouldn't be His last intervention. The second most important day of my life. The next year was full of culture shock. I was in a whole new world and just trying to learn how to respond to it. I mean, God got me 10 years earlier than I had planned. I went from a basketball team where most of my friends were black to a church community where all my friends were white. You can hang out in a group for only so long before you start trying to live like them and look like them. I started wearing American Eagle. I started wearing Hollister. I traded my baggy jeans for skinny jeans with holes in them. I went the whole nine yards. You have to understand, no one in my church dressed like the kids at my school, so I adapted. The funny thing is, I didn't just change the way I dressed. I also changed the places I ate. I don't know if this is a white thing or a Christian thing, but I discovered the second trinity of the church: Starbucks, Chipotle, and Chick-fil-A. All places I had never been before, I started hanging out with white Christians. Don't lie, you know you've been to at least one of these places in the last 3 days. Fast forward 2 weeks from the night I was saved, and we come to the second most important day of my life, the day discipleship began. A man in the new church I was attending, a guy named Kevin Batista, heard I had given my life to Christ. He sought me out to challenge me to follow him as he followed Christ. The following pattern is crucial to everything else I'm going to say. If you don't learn anything else from this book, just make sure you get this pattern. I promise it will make all the difference. Here it is. Jesus invited me to follow him. I accepted Jesus' invitation. Kevin, who had been following Jesus longer than I had, invited me to follow him as he followed Jesus. I accepted Kevin's invitation. I followed him as he followed Christ. I had no idea how important it is for a young Christian to be discipled by an older and more mature believer. Heck, I didn't even know what discipleship is. Thank God Kevin did. I thank God even more that Kevin didn't just know about discipleship, but had dedicated his life to doing it. And not the kind of cheap discipleship that has become so commonplace in today's church. Kevin was into the real deal discipleship modeled by Jesus in the Gospels. What do I mean by that? Well, most Christians think of discipleship as simply a meeting over coffee to pray, read the Bible, and share a little bit about life. Of course, there's never been anything wrong with some good old scripture, a triple shot of espresso, a couple of high fives, and goodbyes. Coffee and conversation are awesome things to do with one another. But coffee and conversation aren't discipleship. Jesus didn't invite the disciples to go have coffee with him. He invited them to go do life with him. So Kevin and I didn't really do the whole coffee and conversation thing. Over the year and a half that Kevin discipled me, we probably met one-on-one only two or three times. Kevin wasn't interested in inviting me to a quick catch-up on the week. He wasn't interested just in who I was dating or how many quiet times I had. He wanted to know about my entire life, and he wanted to invite me into his. So that's what we did together. Life. Kevin pulled back the curtain on his reality, not limiting our time together to an hour before the real day began or an hour after it had already ended. He didn't give me his leftovers. He gave me the main course. Kevin didn't want me just to know something new. He wanted me to be something new. He invited me to leadership meetings, to social gatherings, to a small group, even into time with his family. He gave me the opportunity to really see into his life. He didn't just show me what he wanted me to see. He let me see all of it, the good, the bad, and the ugly. And look, some of it was good, some of it was bad, and some of it was ugly. But all of it was real, and that's what I needed. Even so, the more I saw, the more I realized I wanted to be like him. Was he perfect? No. But was he trying hard to be like Jesus? Definitely. I define discipleship as this: frequently following someone who is spiritually a step ahead. I earnestly wanted to know the Bible like Kevin did. I wanted to love strangers like Kevin did. I wanted someday to be a good husband and father like Kevin was. I wanted to love Jesus like Kevin loved Jesus. And eventually, I wanted to disciple someone like Kevin discipled me. A lot of people complain about this generation. They're job hopping. They're prolonging adolescence. They're slacktivists. They're still living in my home. But I got from Kevin what few young people get, and that's perspective. Young people may be different from generations before, but if they watch most of their friends making all the same mistakes, it doesn't seem like a mistake. It just seems like a natural part of life. That's where the church should be different. Because discipleship disrupts division. It's a bridge between generations. It gives perspective, vision, and wisdom to those coming up. When Kevin let me see his life, he let me see my potential. Until him, I was just doing what was right in my own eyes. There's a saying, we all learn from our mistakes. But no one said we have to learn from our own mistakes. I've tried to save time by gaining wisdom from the mistakes of those before me, but that became possible only through the corridor of discipleship. Beyond the saving grace of Christ, Kevin's willingness to pour into me is what has made all the difference. It was the left lane of sanctification for me. He led me, which has allowed me to lead others. If it weren't for him, I think I would have spiritually wandered for years trying to figure out, what do I do next? And this is what happens to most young people. Most Christians give their lives to Christ before the age of 18, but here's what I found. Most were saved when they were young, but few were discipled when they were young. Many were never discipled at all. The common denominator among young influencers. I know I'm not the only one who has experienced how formative discipleship is. From what I've seen, discipleship is the common denominator in the lives of young Christians who grow into great leaders. Show me a 20-something leading a nationally impactful ministry or business, and I'll show you someone who had an older, wiser person pour into them. Someone gave them responsibilities they didn't earn and opportunities they didn't deserve. Someone let them fail. Someone challenged them. Someone was willing to let them see their junk and believed in them enough to say the same courageous words Jesus said to his disciples so long ago, "Come, follow me." Under every great young leader is a great foundation of mentors. Shouting this truth from the rooftops is my primary motivation for writing this book, because the church is not doing well with young people. Everyone knows this. What people don't know is that the solution is so much simpler than we think. Too often people ask me to help them reach millennials, and I can tell when they're really just looking for tips and tricks. But my answer is old school. My answer is discipleship. If you want to reach every generation from now until Jesus comes back, disciple someone who disciples someone who disciples someone who disciples someone. You get the picture. Better together. The longer we go without taking discipleship seriously, the wider the chasm between our generations will become. And let's be honest, the chasm is already wide. What I witness in my daily work is that both generations are really turned off by each other. Older people think millennials are lazy and entitled. Millennials think older people just want to criticize them. The tension has gotten so bad that I sometimes worry we are about to give up on one another altogether. But we can't do that, because the truth is that we desperately need each other. Should I say that again? I probably should. I know that generations are frustrated, but the proper way forward is not apart, but together. A house divided cannot stand. The church has never done well when it fractures over minor issues. We are always stronger when we blend and when we highlight what we have in common.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.